So good evening to all the attendees who have gathered here in this webinar, the special public lecture, which is jointly organized by the National Academy of Sciences India Delhi chapter and the MHRD Institution Innovation Council, Deen Dayal Upadhyaya College, under the aegis of DBT Star College program. Today we have with us Professor E.D. Jemmy, who is a fellow of all the science academies, including the Third World Academy of Sciences, and who's also a J.C. Bose Neck Fellow and a Year of Science Chair Professor from CERB DST. And moreover, he's also recipient of the coveted prize of Padma Shri by the Government of India. And this lecture is part of the DST's Golden Jubilee Commemoration Year Celebration. And we have with us on the panel, Professor Ajoy Khattak, who is a Nasi Meghnad Sahar Distinguished Professor and also the chairperson of the Delhi chapter. Along with me, Dr. Getika is a co-host and Dr. Poonam is also there. So without taking much of time and with this brief introduction, I request Professor Jemmy to kindly give his special public lecture and can share his screen.
So thank you, Professor Saxena, for the kind invitation and the kind words of introduction. It is indeed a pleasure for me to give this public lecture. Good day to all of you out there in the different parts of the world. It's always a blessing in disguise in this sense that without moving away from Bangalore, I'm able to present the talk so that so many of you are present to listen. The National Academy of Sciences, Allahabad, as we used to call earlier, you know, NASI is an as old as all the other academies in the country, actually the first academy. And it is a great incentive that the local chapter in Delhi have taken and given to Deen Dayal Upadhyaya College's MHRD Institution Innovation Council. So all of it together, you know, it is a great occasion for me to be in a system that is organizing so many lectures. So thank you very much for this. I have given this title, Benzene to Boron Without Alchemy. I will try to get to some extent of conviction that yes, without alchemy, one can go from benzene to boron, and it's not going to be an easy task. I would generally talk about what is interesting to me. You know, I try to look at relationships between problems in one area to another, trying to get transferable models, you know, like between polymers of elements and their compounds, between organic and organometallic chemistry, among the chemistry of various main group elements, bonding and structure and reactions across the periodic table, rule breaking structures. Basically, I look for specific models rather than a number as an answer. Now, in this context only, I have given this topic, benzene to boron without alchemy. And the, well, you can say why boron? Well, there are lots of interesting reasons, and I wouldn't spend any time on this because all of you know how important an element could be. But my fascination with boron started early on, and it started actually from carbon. Now, why do I say it started from carbon? You know, we know that there is methane, carbon is tetrahedral, sp3 hybridization, and you extend it, you can get diamond. There is trigonal planar carbon, sp2 hybridization, benzene, naphthalene, Hückel-Forent plus 2 pi electron rule, and then goes all the way to graphite, fullerenes, and so on. Pictorially, you can say this way. Yes, there is methane and diamond, and everything in between are saturated hydrocarbons. There is benzene, naphthalene, Hückel, Forent plus 2 pi electron rule, you get graphite, and of late, of course, even graphene. When I initially was thinking about this in my first year undergraduate course, there was no graphene, it was only graphite. We have then C60 nanotubes, all of organic chemistry. There is a beautiful structural relationship in the chemistry of carbon. And I had asked this question, are there equivalents of such relationships in the chemistry of boron? There is, of course, the obvious ones, CH3 plus and BH3, or CH4 and BH4 minus, the standard isoelectronic ones. And what is beyond this is the concern that I had. And this concern brings me to benzene to boron topic, because it is not obvious whether we can very easily get a picture like what we have for carbon for boron. Here, I say, okay, there is benzene. It's aromatic. Everyone knows about it. It has high stability. You can, of course, put them together, benzene, naphthalene, anthracene, and so on, and you get graphene. What is the equivalent of benzene in boron chemistry? It's actually B12, H12, 2 minus. But how do we get there? And if we get there, can we assume that just as benzene can be connected to graphite, is it possible to connect B12, H12, 2 minus to allotropes of boron? We have alpha boron, we have beta rhombohedral boron, and if we also think that that it is all icosahedral, there is something very remarkable. If you remove these 12 hydrogens out of this B12, H12, one suddenly finds that the B12 is flat. A neutral B12 without hydrogen is actually flat. It's structure of, it's a triangle network. And is this an indication that there could be a 2D network for this? And indeed, last few years, we know that there is borophene, just as graphene. But it is also more interesting to say that, okay, if it is B12, we have it flat. But if you have B20, we have it as a bracelet. If you have it as B40, we have actually almost like a fullerene, except larger holes, but it is a triangular fullerene. So we have all these possibilities coming in without our knowing. Now, my attempt will be to give this larger picture of the structural chemistry of boron, and slowly starting from benzene, that too. There are more things that I can say, but I may not reach up to that in the talk, but maybe a part of it will come through. So benzene to boron. How do we go from benzene to boron? Let's start with benzene and remove two electrons. We have a dication. Now, if you look at the structure of this dication, it is a pentagonal pyramid. It is not the hexagon. It's a pentagonal pyramid. How do we know? It was told already by Hoogeveen, who made this first time, but people didn't believe it. He had spectral evidence to show that it is a pentagonal pyramid. People didn't believe it and ridiculed him. He was so dejected. It took several years before an X-ray structure of the hexamethyl derivative was published. 3 years ago, there was an X-ray structure corresponding to this, right? Now, this is still carbon. It is benzene dication. But how is it that I'm connecting it to boron? I connect it to boron saying that, okay, if we had C6H6 plus 2, if I were to replace every carbon by a B minus, right, I would have B6H6 minus 4, plus 2, and 6 boron coming in for 6 carbons, each with a negative charge. So minus 6 plus 4, we have B6H6 minus 4. Now, this is not known, but if there is a way to protonate this 4 times and make it neutral, this is B6H10. And that has been known for a long time. This is a pentagonal pyramid. This is a pentagonal pyramid, right? A pentagonal pyramid, dication with carbon. A pentagonal pyramid neutral because we have 4 bridging hydrogens that has taken care of the charge. Now, this has been known for a long time. Magnesium boride is treated with acid by Stokes in the 30s and got this. Long, long time back. This is B6H10. Now, let us assume that we didn't want to replace all the carbons. We have another chemistry that is coming in. If I had replaced only essentially two carbons by two boron, then it becomes neutral. B4, B2H6. That also is known. One boron here, one boron there and four carbon. These do not appear in organic chemistry. People think it is inorganic, but that's all in our mind, whether it is organic or inorganic. They're all molecules. Now, this connection is interesting because we have to understand why this is so stable. See, benzene is stable, 6 pi electrons, 4n plus 2 pi electron rule, we know it is stable. Why is this one stable? Even more stable, I would say. Why is it? We have to go back to an elementary molecular orbital picture. You know, I have taken the most simple one that everyone understands. We have two hydrogen atoms. You bring them together, you get hydrogen molecule. An interaction diagram of this is there even in plus two books, right? Two hydrogen atoms, it forms a stable bond, two electrons in the stable molecular orbital, right? We could do something similar here. Instead of two hydrogens, on one side, we could say it is C5H5 minus. Chemists will recognize this as cyclopentadienyl anion. And we have CH plus 3 because the total is C6H6 plus 2. If you do an interaction diagram of the same kind, you know, we have the 3 pi orbitals of cyclopentadienyl anion, three of these, and then the CH with its 3 frontier orbitals, you know, an sp hybrid and 2p orbitals, you find that there is a strong stabilization of these already stabilized and delocalized pi MOS. Now, this causes the stabilization. In fact, schematically, one can say that the benzene's 3 pi MOS are stabilized further. It has come down in energy. And we have this. So it is a three-dimensional delocalization. This was two-dimensional. This is three-dimensional. This way, we have suddenly jumped into boron from carbon. But if you can do it for benzene to benzene dication, why not to the tetracation? If you do it for the tetracation, it is C6H6 plus 4. Terrible from the charge. But if you were to replace four carbons by four boron, we have the neutral C2B4H6. Or if you replace all of the 6 by B6, we have B6H6 minus 2. Instead of minus 4, it's only minus 2 because we started with plus 4 charge. Right? This is also known. Now, if we can do that with 6-membered ring to get this, we can do it with 5-membered ring to get a trigonal bipyramid. We could start with tropylium cation, C7H7 plus, and get B7H7 2 minus. Right? These are ways of getting from aromatic systems of the carbon kind to three-dimensional delocalized boron structures. Now, this doesn't stop there. In fact, we could expand this picture suddenly by condensing, and I won't spend much time, except to say that, yes, from here you can go to graphene. From two of these can get to an icosahedron. Two of these could get to a 14-vertex system, and so on, right? We have many possibilities, but that's not my importance today. I would say, what are the polyhedral borains that we know? In fact, BN, HN minus 2, and going from 5 all the way to 12 is known, right? All of them are dianions. And Ken Wade has even a rule which says that, of course, the stability of these will be there only if you have minus 2 charge. And we can have a simple interaction diagram, which is not so important right now, to show that, yes, this rule works well. But there is more to this, right? Just as benzene is the most stable aromatic system, B12H12-2- seems to be the most stable of these polyhedral boranes. Why is it most stable? You know, I could have skipped this explanation and gone on, but I felt this is important. It has an orbital engineering idea that is crucial for the chemistry of boron. Why is icosahedral arrangement the best for boron? It is not the best for carbon. It is not the best for nitrogen. It is not so good for aluminum or even gallium, even though we can get structures similar. Why is it so? Let's take the most symmetric of these polyhedral boranes and look at their relative stability. The most stable one, number one, is icosahedral B12H12-2-. The next is B6H6-2-. Third is B5H5-2-. And the fourth is B7H7-2-. So the order of stability is not based on size. Normally, we would have thought a minus two charged species. Yes, this is the most stable one. This is the largest. But then the next one is B7H7 2 minus. That's not the most stable. That's the least stable of these four, right? B6H6 minus 2 comes in. Why is this differences? How do we understand this? Let's take the middle two first, right? These two, and we know which one is more stable, right? The B6H6 is more stable than B7H7. This is less than B6H6 2 minus. Why is it so? How do we understand this? We can treat this as a ring interacting with the two caps, like a ring interacting with two caps. Before we try to understand this, we have already seen a ring interacting with one cap, right? And that is this interaction diagram, right? We had seen cyclopentadienyl anion interacting with the CH. And we found that three molecular orbitals are stabilized, and so we have a stability. Now, these are the MOs we are talking about. Let us look at them more closely. For a series of such systems, this we have looked at. And if you look at the structures, one finds that the CH here is bent closer to the carbon. In VH plus alpha it is. On the other hand, at the end here, they are bent away. So it is almost as though the shape of this ring with the CH is controlled by what is there on the top. If you have a very, very contracted orbital here, these will go up and redirect the orbital. If it is appropriate, then there is no change. If it is not, if it is a very large orbital, then of course you rehybridize bending it. Now this gives us some clue to the problem. Obviously, if you have one more group coming from the other side, this option of bending goes away because the highly symmetric structure demands that this is in the plane, which means that without any bending, there should be optimum overlap of orbitals. We can call it orbital engineering. Now, you know, it's engineering. I mean, if you have a ring and a cap, it's like a pillars and a roof, right? Pillars and a roof. If you have the pillars kept, you know, nearly constant and the roof is changed, you know, we can't really fit this here. You can kind of make believe and do this by tilting these pillars. Not with a very favorable situation, but you can do that. Something similar is done in the molecular structures as well. See, this B5 system seems to be too large compared to the orbitals on this. So we have to shift these bend, and it's almost like this, right? Let us take this idea further, specifically for B6H6 2 minus, and see what are the options. See, we have three scenarios. Here, the cap is too large. Here, the cap is too small. Neither of it is ideal. While in the middle here, these two seem to be fitting very well. So B6H6 2 minus is a situation like this. On the other hand, B7H7 2 minus, it's as though the ring is too large and the caps have two contracted orbitals. So it is like this, not a very great situation. Now, if you go to the three-membered ring-based polyhedra, we find that the ring is too small and the cap has, relatively speaking, larger diffuse orbitals. So this is also not so very great. So we have, obviously, the idea that the pentagonal bipyramid is not as good as octahedron, while the trigonal bipyramid is intermediate. But it doesn't still say why B12H12 2 minus is so stable. So we have to see that specifically because it is an important aspect in the chemistry of boron. Let us try to look at this. We have the icosahedron. We could say that, okay, it is constructed from two pentagonal pyramids, like 2B6H10, where we have knocked off these hydrogens. If you do that, you know, the pentagonal pyramid, the B6H10 structure that we have seen, this has essentially the BH bending away from the five-membered ring by about 24.2 degrees, right? 24.2. Now, if you look at the solid geometry of icosahedron and look at the centroid and draw a line passing through one of the vertices and look at this five-membered ring and what is the angle that this particular extension makes with this plane, it is 26.6. This is out of the solid geometry of the icosahedron. These two numbers are so close that in forming the icosahedron with two pentagonal filaments, the molecule did not have to distort much. The ideal geometry is what is required as well. Right? This gives us the idea that yes, B12H12 2- is indeed the building block for boron. Now, having gone from benzene to B12H12 2-, let us come back to our picture. Well, there are more innovative scientists like Buckminster Fuller, after whom fullerenes are named, or high energy physicists who look at the shape of the universe. They all come to these high symmetry structures. But those are, you know, interesting ways that we can divert, but not today. Let us come back to this picture. What do we have? We have B12H12 2- as the most stable arrangement. Just as benzene is the most stable aromatic system going to graphite, the thermodynamically most stable allotrope, we would imagine that B12H12 2- should go all the way to alpha rhombohedral boron, which is not the thermodynamically most stable one, but the next one, and to beta rhombohedral boron, which is a complex one, but that is the most stable one, and of course, rest of them. So we can try to make the simplest of the structures first, that is the alpha rhombohedral boron, because it has only B12 units. The only trick is that these B12 units are connected in some fashion that it has to have extra 2 electrons, because we know B12 requires extra 2 electrons according to Waite's rule. And how do we get that? There's a trick, not a very complex trick. What it does is, first of all, these three borons here, they are connected to another B12 through two center 2 electron bonds, just as BH bond, two center 2 electron bonds to boron above. Similarly, these three below would connect to other boron atoms of other B12 through two center 2 electron bonds. On the other hand, you know, the BH is removed. So we have an sp hybrid here, we have another sp hybrid, and the third one. Now we come back to the same interaction diagram here. We have H2. Now we have H3, let us assume, a triangular H3. We have three hydrogen atoms, three electrons, and three molecular orbitals. But these two molecular orbitals are higher in energy, and we actually can fill these two. We have an extra electron. We say H3+ is stable. This extra electron, you know, this same system, same kind of an interaction exists here. We have BH, SP hybrid, another SP hybrid, and a third one, right? And we have two electrons, because the third electron we can save. And we save like that, two-thirds electron use and one-third obtained. And if you consider this three-dimensional structure, we save enough electrons to have two electrons per B12. So in alpha rhombohedral boron, we have two electrons extra by the sharing mechanism for each B12. So this is the second most thermodynamically stable allotrope. This is simple enough. It is there even in textbooks. But ideally, what we would have had is that a B12, right, a B12, and each of the boron here connected to another B12. Right? The problem is that it doesn't form a space filling model. Translational symmetry is not achieved. And there are some structures which are very close to it, like YB66, that is Y24, Y is yttrium, B1584. We have been trying to understand this from this point of view, not successful yet. But what boron has done is that it starts with B12 and then try to connect to other B12s in a different way and go further. It's a very complex thing, but we will go through this quickly. Right, we have B12, and what we will ideally do now is to give an idea of beta rhombohedral boron's unit cell, an idealized unit cell with 105 atoms. We start with B12. Ideally, we should connect to 12 B12. So I have connected, instead of one B12, I have connected half of a B12. I could connect, for example, six of these half B12s, and you could still understand. There are still six borons left. This is B12. Six of them have B12s. I mean, B6, half of an icosahedron. And I will add another six half icosahedra here. That means half, I mean, pentagonal pyramid. If I do that, Suddenly, it appears as though it is C60. If you didn't look carefully enough, it would have been treated as C60. It's actually C60 kind. The outer surface is identical in some sense to the symmetry of C60, except below each of the five-membered rings. C60 has 12 five-membered rings. Here also we have 12 five-membered rings. I have shown 6 here. I have shown 12 of them here. Except below each five-membered ring, we have one boron atom. So this is a pentagonal pyramid. And this boron atom is connected to the inner B12. So we have a inner B12. And then another set of B12 that are these separate ones. And above this, outside, we have B60. That is the 12 pentagons. Now, the attempt of nature, because we know B12 is the most stable one, to make every atom possible as a part of the B12. One way of doing that will be bring two of these together, right? If I bring two of them together, there is, of course, a pentagonal pyramid. There is another pentagonal pyramid, right, of these two B84s, and we have suddenly formed one icosahedron. Of course, there is one problem. You know, there are, you know, B84 is large, and we can bring only 6 of these second B84s around one B84, which means that we can salvage, so to speak, 6 pentagonal pyramids in this fashion. So what do we do for the remaining one? Well, you know, the unit cell is very large, 105 atoms. There is an unusual beaten unit in this, right? This is a beaten unit. Let us look at it closely. We have a pentagon here. We have another pentagon on this side. We have a third pentagon at the other end. And there is an atom in the middle. So looking from this side or this side or from this side, it's like a pentagonal pyramid. Now, if you put this on the top of a B84, like there is a B84, and I have put this, suddenly we find that this is actually an icosahedron, right? We can put one here and one here as well, right? So we have a beaten here connected to 3 V84. And if you consider this, this is one B12. There is a second B12. There is a third B12, all of them sharing the central atom here. And of course, some edge sharing as well. Now, the structure is getting complex. No wonder why this is not there in textbooks. No wonder it took me 30 years since I asked this question in 1968 to even come to an understanding, right? But this is not the end of it. Actually, the unit cell has a unit like this connected to another unit of the same kind, where a triangular three-atom unit is connected to another one of the same kind through a single boron atom. Difficult to show. So what I have done is, you know, just as we can cut a naphthalene out of graphene, add hydrogens and draw the structure, I will cut this part out of it. Now, what is this part? It has a beaten, it has another B6, a second B6, and a third B6. So 3 B6, it is 18, and there is this 10, so 28. This 28 atom unit is connected to another 28 atom unit through a single boron atom. So this is complex, but you can see this. I have taken a side view now. This is the single atom, and this is the B28. There is the B28. Now we can count the 105 atoms in many ways, but one way will be we have a B84, B10, B10, that is these ones. But we can also count the total number of B12 units. We have a B48 and B28, BB28 unit. That means 4 B12 and a B57. B57 because this is the B28 here, second B28 and connected to a boron atom. It adds on to 105, 48 plus 57. This is the idealized unit cell. Now, this B1 of 5, I said 4 B12. B12 we know already because Wade has given us the idea that it has to be -2 charge species. So 4 B12, that's 12, 2 minus is equivalent. We need 8 electrons here. B28, BB28, we do not know. Because Wade told us a rule for polyhedra, single polyhedra. We have to go beyond it. So we have to get to another electron counting rule, extending this idea. So Huckel-Poren plus 2 pi electron rule can take us this way. benzene, naphthalene, and ricin. We need to have another rule where we can go from B12 H12 to minus, for example, to B20 H16, where we have four atom sharing, or B30 H24, where we have two triangular face sharing icosahedra, and so on. So we have to get this new rule, and we introduced this new rule many years ago. In other words, the N plus one skeletal electron pair rule, where the one is converted into M, which is the number of polyhedra, and is of course the number of vertices. O is the number of single atom bridge that we have between two polyhedra. Let me give an example. This is one icosahedra connected to another icosahedra through a triangle, right? The total number of atoms will be 12 plus 12 it should have been, but three atoms are common. So instead of 24, it is 21. And these three do not have hydrogen. So we have 18 hydrogens instead of 21 hydrogens. If you use the electron count, M is equal to the number of polyhedra 2, N is number of vertices 21, 0 because O is 0 because these are connected through three atoms, not one atom. And so we should have 23 electron pairs. We count the number, we have 18 BH. Each BH has an electron pair, so we have 18. Because BH, boron has three valence electrons. One is used up in forming the BH, so we have two electrons. And three boron atoms with no hydrogen. So we have 9 electrons, 3 into 3. That means 4.5 electron pairs. So we have 22.5 electron pairs. To make it 23, we need another electron. So B21 H18, if it is to be made, has to be minus 1 charge species. Well, it was a prediction, but fortunately, it was made 7 years afterwards. And a lot of interesting chemistry comes in. Now we can use this rule now to get all kinds of things. I don't spend much time on this. If we had four atom sharing, we find that what is available, what is required is 22, what is available is 22, and so this would be neutral. This was not really a prediction. Lipscomb, who got a Nobel Prize for borane, has made this, but you know that was an accident. He got this structure and he felt all polyhedral boranes that he know is minus 2. This is neutral. So he published this paper and left it at this. So he just didn't worry about it further. Now, you can see how one can combine these things. From one polyhedra, I can put them together in many ways. From one of them, I can remove one vertex and get a NADO system. I can take one of these and get, you know, basically the amount that is, the chemistry that is to be discovered, a lot is discovered, a lot more remains to be done. One can do many things, but I will skip this and go further. Well, these are not as important. Coming to our initial question, why did we need the rule? We wanted to find out how do we find the requirement of electrons. Now, if you do this count again, right, the same way as I have done, we have essentially 8 polyhedra, 57 vertices, one for O because single atom bridge. We have 66. On the other hand, if you count the number of electrons, not very difficult, 67.5. So there should be a plus 3 charge. We have to get rid of 3 electrons. You can calculate B57, H36 plus 3. It is aromatic. And now we have come back to this picture. 8 electrons here we need. Here we have plus 3, minus 8 and plus 3. So B105 minus 5 would have been ideal. But a solid has to be neutral. Elemental boron has to be neutral. If you do a band structure study, you find that yes, it is like metallic, but then that doesn't conform to the experiment. So obviously the vacancy of these 5 electrons are felt. The material has some solution. How do we get to that solution? We went back to the reported X-ray structure by that time, because I had this question from 68, 78, but 88, you know, there was an X-ray structure which said the idealized unit cell is 105, but a better refinement of the data will be obtained if you add fractionally 1.66 boron atoms more. Now 1.66 boron atoms, you know, one boron has 3 electrons. 1.6 into 3, 66 into 3 is exactly 5 electrons. And these 5 electrons solve the problem of electron deficiency. So we come back here. B12 minus 8, B57 plus 3, right? B105 minus 5. We add this 1.66 and we have 106.66, right? So it looks as though the problem is solved. And I thought, yes, the answer is there. But nature is more demanding. Nature does not want a charge separation. B57 part plus 3 and B48 minus 8. What it does instead is something remarkable. You know, when you refine the same one, you find that B57 really has only 56 atoms. Only 56 atoms. One atom is missing from this B57. You know, this is the B28, B28 with 1. And we look, where can that atom be missing most favorably? You find that out of these two triangles, one atom is taken away. That's the best possible B56. Now, look at the experiment again. There were three experiments. And these experiments differed only by the rate at which they cooled the boron melt. You find that as, you know, the number one experiment was the fastest cooling, then second, and third was the lowest cooling. You find that if it were ideally one out of the six missing, we should have 83.33% occupancy. But what is observed is first experiment 73, second 74, and third 77. I'm pretty sure if the experiment can be done still slower, the atoms would have enough time to reorganize and get to this. But there was no understanding as to what causes this different ratios at different experiments in 1988. Now, something more happens. Around this area, there is extra occupancies coming in, which is not a part of the unit cell. And those extra occupancies decreases as the rate of cooling decreases. So there is some kind of a combination between these two playing. And if you think that these two together is probably contributing to this total 83.33%, maybe that is one way of looking at this. When we do this, you find that there is also additional occupancy coming in about 44% in a six-fold place. And that corresponds to, you know, 2.66 into 3. That is, if you had 44%, you can say 4 out of 6 would be occupied, right? Which means that instead of 1.66, we should have 2.66 boron atoms. That would be 8 electrons. Now, with this, we come back here, right? We have 4B12 minus 8, B57 plus 3. But now, we have 4B12, 1B56, and a B2.66 instead of 1.66. So we have the same ratio, of course, B106.66, but there is no charge separation. The 2.66 boron atoms are around the 4B12s. This is really predicting and explaining a lot of chemistry. I don't have the time to go through this in greater detail because we have equally important things to talk about further. But you can imagine, you know, the nature of the problem. Every experiment seems to give a slightly different result because nature demands that there is no charge separation. Nature demands that there has to be an electron count that is satisfied. And this can be satisfied in many different ways. So I would leave this interesting topic, which is bringing in a lot of metal boride chemistry, boron-rich metal solids, materials, some of it could be seen here. Let us come back to this. We have gone from B12 to alpha rhombohedral boron. We have gone from B12 through this lab rather laborious polyhedral condensation rules to beta rhombohedral boron. The tau boron can be done in a similar fashion. Interesting, some twist is there, but I would skip that and come to something equally interesting. Now, if you replace, I said earlier, if we replace the 12 hydrogens, we get a trianguline structure, a flat trianguline structure. One could almost think that, yes, we could go ahead and do this. Well, I had taken a blank pointer, I see. We could make a two-dimensional structure out of it. it is almost like graphene and benzene. You know, you have benzene and you have graphene. Similarly, if you have taken 12 hydrogens away, and many people have suggested this, I haven't, first time. We have a trianguline structure. And if you want to consider a 2D structure of this, obviously we have a graphene-like structure, except it is not hexagonal, hexagons alone, but it's only triangles. It's as if in the middle of every hexagon, we have added an atom, right? To show this relationship, let me draw slightly differently. We have a new atom added in the middle of each hexagon, and we have this triangular structure, right? Elemental boron has a graphene-like sheet. I mean, these are speculations. You know, speculations in 2007, you know, it's very interesting calculation. It said, well, the structure is bound, you know, the binding energy per boron is about 6 electron volt. But if you let it relax, you find that, yes, the best structure would have one row of boron going up, another row of boron coming down, a third one going up, and so on. A triangulated kind of structure. But what is even more interesting is that if you remove one out of 9 boron atoms and make these holes, that is even more stable. Now this is 6.31, 6.0, 6.2, and 6.31. So there is something very interesting happening. We have been looking at this in 2006 and 7, except that we called it not borophene, but borograph at that time. And the student who did this was completing his thesis at the end of 2007 and left. And I had to stop this work for some time. Next 5 years, I didn't do anything in this area. But when I came back in 2013, something interesting happened. There were lots of calculations on this, you know, different 2D structures of borophene kind. Each one was done with a different density functional that is used. And it's a DFT method, but you know, different functional by each person, you can't even compare the relative energies. So we decided that we will have a uniform functional used and calculate all of them again. And here I have given relative energies in terms of milli electron volt. So what we had seen in the last slide of 1/9 hole density, that is 1 out of 9 boron atoms missing, that is the most stable one. And I have given zero value for that, right? The non-zero numbers would be structures that are higher in energy. If it is without any holes, it is 92 milli electron volt higher. And if you have more holes, also it is not as good. So something unusual is happening. That is, this 1/9 hole density borophene is more stable. Now, it was a curiosity. We have to understand why this is. And when we were worrying about this, you know, 2013, 14, 15, suddenly from 2015 onwards, there were papers coming one after another, experimental realization of borophene. They never existed before 2015. And suddenly there was excitement, more excitement than we ever thought. What is the reason for the extra stability of 1/9 hole density? We have to go back. Go back to the same benzene, benzene dication, and tetracation. You know, what is interesting is, you know, from benzene, we get graphene, right? Now, this structure was available as MgB2 from the beginning of last century, except in 2001, Akimitsu took this structure and found that it is superconducting at at 40 degree Kelvin. And that was big sensation. But the structure was very interesting. It's almost as though it is graphene, except every carbon of the graphene is replaced by a B minus. So we have a graphene of B minus, and for every 2 B minus, we have an Mg plus 2, Mg plus 2 sitting above the ring. So we have a layer of B minus graphene, we have a layer of Mg plus 2 graphenic structure. Now, these plus 2 and minus 1 for magnesium and boron are for electron counting purposes. Actually, the boron is never B minus full. It is a fraction of negative charge, and Mg is never plus 2. But what is interesting is that this is isoelectronic. If you want to consider this layer and these two together to graphene, right? This borophene with Mg is isoelectronic to graphene. And if you were to now replace this Mg by a boron, right? If you replace this Mg by a boron, all that we have is everything is boron. With Mg, we had a different layer coming in because these are not the same atoms. Even the radii are different. But here, whether the boron is a part of the B2 that we started with or the Mg replacement, they are all boron. So we have a structure which is, of course, the standard triangulene kind of borophene, except one catch. The catch is that if we remove one Mg by a boron, like Mg3B6 and B3B6, we find that for each Mg replaced by a boron, we have an extra electron. Right, B3B6, then three extra electrons. How do we get back to the graphenic electron count? If we can remove one boron atom, as we have done here, just remove three valence electrons. So out of the nine boron atoms, we have removed one boron, and that has already given us the possibility that we can get to a structure that has similar electron count as graphene. And this I thought, it's a simple justification for the stability of the 1 by 9 hole density, right? I mean, it was published some time back. But what is interesting is that none of the experiments that was done are actually standalone borophene kind, because these are tough experiments. One is trying to deposit boron atoms on a silver 111 surface in the beginning. And these form borophene sheet on the metal, and it is looked at by scanning Thelenium electron microscope to see what is the pattern that is generated. And one finds that all of them have hole densities which are much higher than the 1 by 9. Right? So this 1 by 9 hole density that one calculates for a standalone borophene sheet is only in the theoretician's mind. Experimentally, we do not have this. All of them are on metal surfaces, and all of them have larger hole density than the 1 by 9. And we said, all right. You know, many people, you know, I'm the only one who have done it. Many people have tried immediately, many calculations. And we wanted to see what happens on a metal surface. And when you calculate this on a metal surface, this is on a 111 silver surface, and you find that what we had obtained as an experimental, I mean, as a computational, most stable borophene, that is not the most stable anymore. The one that was the flat without any holes is also not good. But as you increase the hole density, suddenly the stability increases. So hole densities of 1 by 5 and 1 by 6 are closer to the most stable arrangement than this. Now, experiments are very complex, and these are not so easily reproduced in the initial stages, but repeated experiments have shown that yes, much larger hole densities than 1 by 9 is obtained on silver and even on other metals. Now, there are far more complex relationships that are existing, and we have a recent review that will tell you in what all ways one can go along with this particular idea. So why is it that on a silver 111 surface, suddenly there is more hole density? Not a very complex thing to understand. With 1 by 9 hole density, we know that the electrons are just sufficient, like in graphene. But if we have to have any interaction at all with a silver 111 surface, the silver would like to donate, especially because of the reasonably low work function of silver. If there is to be a strong interaction between the borophene sheet and the metal, there has to be possibility for electron donation to the metal, from the metal to the borophene sheet. But 1/9 whole density Bohr affinity does not require any electrons. Now, how can it be made to require electrons? You increase the number of holes. When you increase the number of holes, of course, the stability increases on the metal surface. And of course, silver 111 is more easily amenable surface than, say, copper and gold. Gold is far more complex. If one were to deposit boron atoms on it, experimentally, one is not able to get a uniform surface. What is done is a very ingenious experiment. You can see the details in this review, but there are lots of, the papers are exploding in the last 3 years, and I haven't given enough credit to all of them, because that's what is the heart of this area. An alloy of gold and boron is made, and then the boron is squeezed out by controlled lowering of the temperature to get a layer of boron on gold. So there are a lot of interesting things, but one can immediately say that yes, more holes are required if the metal has to stabilize it. This also tells about the property of borophene versus graphene. Graphene, yes, material is good. There are lots of properties, lots of interesting applications are there. But if you want to make it electron rich or electron poor, there's only one way. We have to dope with either boron or nitrogen. We have to replace carbon by boron or carbon by nitrogen. But if you want to do that in borophene, you don't have to add another type of atom. We just have to have more holes or less holes. These are very interesting happenings in the field of boron chemistry, in the field of chemistry, in the field of material science right now, in the last 3-4 years. We could also see why there is buckling if there is no holes. And that's not very complex. You know, we say that there are more electrons. That means electrons have gone to antibonding bands, and antibonding interaction can be decreased if you tilt, if you somehow lift one carbon above and decrease this antibonding interaction. Right? This is what is happening in a simple-minded way. It's not very difficult. Even most elaborate most band structure calculations come to the same conclusion. Now, graphene, with its connection now to borophene, have a lot more to offer than I can talk in this. You could see in a recent paper that we had. But you know what is interesting is I'll just give one point and try to stop. And that is, if you were to consider two borophenes coming together, right? Two borophene sheets with no holes, right? We have a borophene sheet, we have another borophene sheet. We know borophene is stable if there is 1/9 hole density. But if it is a dimer of two borophene sheets, there are many opportunities to solve this problem. If we have one boron forming a bond with a boron in the adjacent sheet, right? This way, we will form a 2-centered electron bond. This, of course, not going to be flat anymore. But if you do this exercise, we have a 2-centered electron bond. We are removing one electron out of the picture, right? If we have 3 out of 9 boron atoms doing this, then we have gone back to the graphene electronic structure. In fact, what is interesting is a borophene bilayer of this kind has an electronic structure very similar to that of graphene, in fact, including a Dirac cone. So there is a lot of things that is happening, and I will stop at this stage. We have probably just 5 minutes in this. So what is interesting is we have started, well, you know, there are more things happening here. I didn't have the time to even think about what could have happened if we had, instead of B12, if you had increased the number of boron atoms, right? By the time you get to B20, it is a bracelet kind of structure, B40 like this, and large number of experiments are going on in this area, and people are trying to understand what is the nature of this fullerene. It's called borosferine. It's actually a three-dimensional structure like fullerene, mostly triangles, but in this particular case of B40, we have 4 7-membered rings and 2 6-membered rings. So the area of boron is exploding, and you know, carbon has taken more than 100 years to reach where it is, to have the relationship between methane to diamond, to benzene to graphene, to C60 and fullerenes and nanotubes, and so on. Here we are just beginning. It may take a little longer for us to reach the same understanding. I will thank Professor Manoj Saxena and his colleagues, the NASI local chapter, its president, the Department of Science and Technology, DDU's Institution Innovation Council of MHRD, and my department, our computing facility, the CRB of DST, which is funding me generously, and my students, postdocs. In fact, the current group is here. And I really thank for your kind attention at this time of the COVID, which gave this opportunity for me to talk to a group of you in different parts of the world. Thank you very much.
That's so nice. That, yes, yes. So I may request now Professor Ajoy Ghatak if he can say a few words before we conclude the session. If he is able to.
Well, I can only express my sincere thanks to Professor Jemmins for this wonderful lecture. I just now saw all the questions and comments. And I'm not a chemistry man, but I can see the significance. I have little interest in graphene. I had once studied a little bit of graphene, but other than that, but the questions and the remarks that have been put by the listeners is very gratifying. We are extremely grateful to you for your time and for your effort and the ease with which you have covered so many aspects. So thank you very much, Professor Jemmins.